Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Today we are starting the bleeding disorders. Bleeding disorders are disorder that are related to bleeding from any part of the human body, and this may be an acquired one or inherited tendency to bleed excessively. The main problem is either in the platelets or due to some factors deficiency that lead to the inability of a person to form a clot during a normal physiological processes. Platelet is the main cell of the blood that is responsible to contribute in the formation of platelet plaque, and then secondly it also helpful for the generation of the thrombus. We have learned the normal hemostasis that maintains the integrity of the circulatory system, that is the formation of loose platelet plaque that is initially formed by the activation of platelets. Platelet activation releases adenosine. This adenosine diphosphate along with the calcium ion and p-selectin molecule adhere with each other with the molecular adhesion that facilitates tissue factor. Accumulation of the tissue factor in the platelet initiates the conversion of thrombus to the fibrin clot by the coagulation cascade. This was the general picture. So in bleeding disorder, either the very initial step is not there, or maybe there is a problem in the last step. Starting and end steps are very important in the bleeding disorder that result in the alteration and the bleeding tendency. This is the mechanism of bleeding, that due to the problem in the vascular integrity, there are platelets and clotting factors, and there may, after the formation of clot, there will be the fibrinolysis. The arrangement of any of these factors like platelets, like clotting factors deficiency, excessive fibrinolysis will cause the abnormal bleeding. What is the general picture of the bleeding disorder? Here it may be epistaxis, that is the bleeding from the nose. It may be a gingival hemorrhage, it may be a mucosal bleeding, or if it is a female, the menstruation will be very heavy. There will be a very high bleeding after the childbirth. There is easy bruisability, bleeding following the tooth extractions. There may be the formation of hematomas. There may be a hematoma, that is the collection of blood outside the blood vessels. Most commonly, hematomas are caused by an injury to the wall of a blood vessels that causing the blood to seep out from the blood vessels to the surrounding tissues. There may be hematuria, that is the bleeding into a joint. It is the most common cause of the joint swelling and the pain, especially if it is monoarticular. Some drugs are there that are causing the bleeding, that are aspirin, irreversible blocker of the platelets, that blocks the platelets to form a platelet plaque. It may be the excessive use of warfarin, and this warfarin may link with the suppression of the vitamin K dependent coagulating factors. Clotting factors are deficient. Now again, the platelet plaque may form, but it cannot be strengthened by the fibrin. Then other NSAIDs, including the aspirin, like ibuprofen, naproxen, they are mainly the inhibitor of prostaglandins, and then these prostaglandins also have a mucus protecting effects. If they are deficient, there is more chance of the bleeding. Beta-lactam antibiotics, they directly impair hemostasis by two non-immune mechanisms. Either they are interfering with the hepatic activation of the clotting factors like clotting factor 2, 7, 9 and 10, and they are mainly causing the hypoprothrombinemia. Secondly, they are also interfering with the platelet aggregation to aggregate. They inhibit the platelet aggregation. So by these two mechanisms, they have tendency to induce bleeding, especially post-surgically. This effect is very pronounced. Certain herbal medications also act in the same way. There are several mechanisms are there. The most commonly herbal supplements are the aloe vera, cranberry, garlic, ginger, turmeric, white willow. They behave like an anticoagulant, and they increasing the tendency of bleeding by several types of mechanisms. So one must remember, due to the vitamin K deficiency, either acquired or genetic, we have again the bleeding tendency. Previously, the term hemorrhagic disease of the newborn is referred to the bleeding disorder that are mainly associated with the hemophilia. However, vitamin K deficiency is also a reason for the bleeding, as several coagulating factors are dependent on the vitamin K. Vitamin K dependent coagulating factors are factor 2, 7, 9, 10 and protein C and S. We have understand that protein C and S, basically these two proteins are inhibitory proteins that manage or balance the clotting mechanism. Combined deficiency of vitamin K dependent factors may result from the condition that either may be acquired or either may be due to the drugs. These drugs, that is anti-epileptic and anti-tuberculosis drug, mainly causing the deficiency of vitamin K, that in turn leading to the bleeding from the gums, etc. Another vitamin C deficiency is lead to the scurvy. Basically, vitamin C is essential for the formation of the blood vessels, and in this scenario, the small blood vessels become fragile. In case of deficiency of vitamin C, they break easily. Due to this point, there may be a spontaneous bleeding, pain in the limb, especially legs may be swell, there may be an anemia. So overall, there is also a bleeding. Due to use of broad spectrum antibiotics, again there will be the bleeding due to several mechanisms, like there may be a suppression of the bone marrow that lead to the thrombocytopenia. There may be a immunological destruction of the platelets. There will be the inhibition of the clotting factors due to the use of the broad spectrum antibiotics, or it may be due to the potentiation of their effects by the that is, for example, warfarin, or due to the other types of mechanism. Example is the chloramphenicol that is causing the aplasia of the bone marrow. If we want to differentiate the bleeding that is either from the platelet defect or either due to the clotting factor deficiency, some clinical characteristic will give you insight that is that you are able to differentiate the bleeding and the cause of the bleeding. For example, if the site of the bleeding is the skin, mucous membrane and the GI and genitourinary tract, the most probable cause of the platelet deficiency. However, if there is a bleeding in the deep in the soft tissue joints, that mainly due to the deficiency of the clotting factor. In case of the platelet deficiency, there will be a bleeding after a minor cut, while in case of deficiency of clotting factor, it does not usually occur, as normal platelets are functioning, so bleeding after minor cut is not there. Usually petechia is present in case of the platelet deficiency, while it is absent in case of the deficiency of clotting factors. Ichymiosis is a superficial discoloration of the skin due to the bruising, and it is mostly present in the deficiency of platelet or defect of the platelet. However, hematuria, hematomas, and both are present mostly in the deficiency of clotting factor. Bleeding after surgery is very immediate in case of platelet deficiency, while it is delayed in case of the clotting factor deficiency. This is the general appearance of the petechia and the purpura. You can notice that petechia are the pinpoint round spots on the skin as a result of the bleeding, and that is the acute bleeding. It causes the petechia to appear either red, brown or purple. It may also look like a cluster, and sometimes it looks like a rash. This is the web type appearance of the blood vessels, showing the spider web. So you have to take the patient history accurately, and you have to determine either it is the acquired one or hereditary. The disorder is either related to platelet or due to the deficiency of the clotting factor, or it's due to the fibrinolysis or due to the deficiency of Willebrand factors, or due to any medication. So history is very important. If we talk about the hereditary disorder, there may be a deficiency of the clotting factors like hemophilia, like fibrinogen deficiency, or like von Willebrand deficiency. If it is a platelet disorder, these are the Glanzmann thrombocytopenia, Bernard-Solon syndrome and the platelet granular syndromes. Overall is the hereditary deficiency of the tendency of the clotting system, all lead to the bleeding. Fibrinolytic disorders include alpha-2 antiplasmin deficiency, or PA1 deficiency, or there may be some structural disorders that lead to the hemorrhages. Acquired are the thrombocytopenia, liver disease in case of the renal failure, vitamin K deficiency, or due to autoimmune disorders that lead to the generation of the antibodies against the coagulating factors. In case of disseminated intravascular coagulation, drugs or lead to the acquired bleeding. How it is diagnosed? You have to determine the platelet count. You have to determine the bleeding time, which is the time of the start of the bleeding from blood rupture of the fingertip and disappearance of the blood on the filter paper. Thrombocytopenia is usually reflected in case of the deficiency of the platelet. There may be qualitative platelet abnormalities. There may be a von Willebrand disease. There may be a vascular purpura, or there may be a severe fibrogen deficiency. After determination of the number of platelets, there is another test, which is the platelet function assay, in which the platelets are exposed to high shear within the capillary tube, and we have to monitor the drop in the flow rate as the platelets form a platelet plug. This is independent of the coagulation factor, and it is also considered as the collagen epinephrine closure time. This is found elevated or abnormal when the person is taking aspirin. Then we have another mediator, which is the collagen adenosine diphosphate closure time. It is the normal in case of the aspirin. Prothrombin time is basically reflective of the checking of the extrinsic pathway. And here we bypass the extrinsic pathway and we are using the thromboplastin to substitute for the platelet. This will differentiate that either that is due to the deficiency of clotting factors or not. If it is normal, then it means that clotting factors in vitamin K dependent factors are normal. They are only altered by the warfarin type drugs. You can see that one factor activated another factor. The infrequent antiphosphate lipid antibodies with antiprothrombin times. Heparin does not prolong the prothrombin time. For heparin, we have to measure APTT time. Here we have to monitor the INR ratio, and INR ratio is basically the ratio of the prothrombin time of the patient with the normal standard prothrombin time, and ISI is considered as the international sensitivity index, which is approximately taken as 1.3 to 1.5. By this formula, after determination of the patient prothrombin time, one can calculate the INR ratio. This is the change of the INR concentration, and the target is to have an INR ratio between 2 to 3 that shows the ideal hemostatic balance. Ideally, 2.5 INR ratio is considered as the condition in which the bleeding and clotting is balanced. If it is very low, if it is low than 2.0, it means the blood started thicker and there is high risk of the coagulation. There will be more chances of the stroke risk, especially if the level falls below the 1. However, if the levels are found above the 3, it shows, it may indicate and it causing the thinning of the blood, and there is more tendency of the bleeding risk. As far as it is increasing up to 5, it means there will be the high risk of the bleeding at that point. APTT is basically the major of the extrinsic and common pathway of the coagulation. It uses the partial thromboplastin time. They are incapable of the activating the extrinsic pathway. The mediator is used, it cannot be able to activate the extrinsic pathway. It only activates the extrinsic pathway. So prolonged deficiency or inhibition of any clotting factors of the extrinsic pathway except 7 may lead to the in prolongation of the APTT time. It is prolonged in the presence of lupus. Basically, it is used to monitor the heparin act. So, this is the extrinsic pathway, or this point is the common pathway of the extrinsic and extrinsic. So, this pathway is mainly inhibited, or determination of this pathway will be from the APTT. Thrombin time. Thrombin time basically measures the conversion of fibrinogen to fibrin monomers and the formation of initial clot by thrombin. It basically reflective of the hypofibrinogenemia or dysfibrinogenesis. If it is increased, then fibrin split products are there. Also, heparin increases can also increase the thrombin time as there is more conversion of fibrinogen to fibrin. If there is a deficiency of fibrin, there will be no formation of fibrin monomers, and the time is will be very high. There is no clot formation in case of the fibrinogen deficiency. This pathway is basically enabled out by the thrombin time. At the end, there is a fibrinolysis, that is fibrin and fibrinogen products get degraded. They are the protein fragments. They are resulting from the action of the plasmin on fibrin on fibrinogen. You can see here factor 11A or 11-12A in turn or an antiplasmin. Factor 11A and 12A basically activate the conversion of plasminogen into plasmin, while antiplasmin and alpha 2 macroglobulin that have an inhibitory effect on the conversion of the plasminogen to plasmin. This plasmin will causing the degradation of the fibrin, it causing the fibrinolysis into fibrin degrading products, FDP. This fibrin is basically formed from the thrombin. Other thing is that that tissue plasminogen activator is there, which activates this enzyme, and we have plasminogen activator inhibitor that inhibit this tissue plasminogen activator. Here you should recall that alkylase, streptokinase, urokinase, they are the basically tissue plasminogen activator, and facilitates the conversion of plasminogen into plasmin that releases the fibrin. Here D-dimer is specifically reflect the fibrinolysis of the cross-linked fibrin. We have other assays for the reflection of the fibrinolysis, that is the assay of the plasminogen, tissue plasminogen activator, alpha 2 antiplasmin. We have the plasminogen activator inhibitor. We can measure the thrombin activated fibrinolysis inhibitor. What are the diseases and what are the results? If we talk about the normal prothrombin time and the APTT, here is the thrombocytopenia or Willi-Wellbrand disease or factor 13 deficiency. Any problem that is mainly related to the platelets will show the normal coagulation pathway. Intrinsic and extrinsic pathway are normal. So there will be a normal PT and there will be normal APTT. If there is a blockade of the intrinsic pathway, the APTT time will be prolonged and the prothrombin time will be normal. Prothrombin time is the reflective of the extrinsic pathway. So in case of hemophilia and factor 9 and 8 deficiency, there will be the prolongation of the APTT pathway, just like that is evident in case of the deficiency in case of hemophilia A. In case of a normal APTT and there is a prolongation of the PT time, it is reflective of a condition of the deficiency of factor 7 or warfarin therapy or liver diseases or early disseminated intravascular coagulation, because they are reflective of the extrinsic pathway inhibition. Extrinsic pathway is not properly working, that increases the at prolonging the prothrombin time. However, if there is a too much vitamin K deficiency, it will convert this point of the prolongation of the PT time to the APTT time, as it blocks the common pathway of the coagulation that result due to the vitamin K deficiency or due to the liver diseases or due to the overuse of the warfarin or due to any acquired inhibition of the factor 5 and 10 or in case of DIC. In bleeding disorder, we will mainly cover the hemophilia. That will be the second lecture of our topic. Thank you.